Penguin Random House Audio presents Andrew Jackson and the Miracle of New Orleans, The Battle That Shaped America's Destiny, by Brian Kilmeade and Don Yaeger. This is the author, Brian Kilmeade. This book is dedicated to the unsung men and women whose faithful military service has kept us free and made generals like Jackson famous. Your names and faces may not be known by the world, but you'll never be forgotten by me. Our situation seemed desperate. In case of an attack, we could hope to be saved only by a miracle or by the wisdom and genius of a commander-in-chief. Accordingly, on his arrival, Jackson was immediately invested with the confidence of the public, and all hope centered in him. We shall, hereafter, see how amply he merited the confidence which he inspired. Major Arsène La Carrière Latour. Historical Memoir of the War in West Florida and Louisiana, 1814 to 1815, with an Atlas, 1816. Prologue. In the spring of 1781, the Redcoats arrived in Upland, Carolina, and they brought terror with them. As they searched the countryside for the rebels, they turned the region the Jackson family called home into an armed camp. Elizabeth Jackson's youngest son, Andrew, though barely 14 years of age, hated their presence and quickly learned just how costly the fight for liberty could be. On April 9th, Andy and his brother Robert, 2 years older, earned the wrath of the invading force by joining a battle to defend the local meeting house against a band of Tories reinforced by British dragoons. The fight went badly for the Americans, but the brothers, unlike a cousin who was severely wounded and captured, were lucky. They escaped, and after spending a night hiding in the brush, the two Jackson boys managed to reach their cousin's home to deliver the news of his fate. Once there, however, their luck ran out. A Tory spy spotted their horses and informed the British of their whereabouts. A lesson in the cruelties of war was soon delivered. As the Jackson brothers stood helplessly at the point of British swords, the enemy set about destroying their aunt and uncle's home. Determined to make an example of these rebels, the Redcoats shattered dishes. They ripped clothing to rags. They smashed furniture. Then, with the house in ruins, the commanding officer decided upon one more humiliation. He chose Andy Jackson as his target. He ordered the tall and gangly Andy Jackson to kneel before him and clean the mud from his boots. The boy refused. "Sir, I'm a prisoner of war and claim to be treated as such." Enraged by the young American's defiance, the British officer raised his sword and brought it down on Jackson's head. Had Andy not raised his arm to deflect the blow, his skull might have split open. As it was, the blade gashed his forehead and sliced his hand to the bone. Not satisfied at drawing blood from Andy, the soldier turned and slashed at his brother, tearing into his scalp, leaving him dazed and bleeding. No one dressed their wounds. Instead, the Jackson brothers were marched 40 miles, with neither food nor water, to join more than 200 other rebellious colonists in a prison camp in Camden. They were fed stale bread, exposed to the smallpox that raged among the prisoners, kept in tightly packed conditions. Their mother, Elizabeth Jackson, had already lost too much. A husband, Andrew Jackson Sr., had worked himself to death shortly before Andrew was even born, leaving the pregnant Elizabeth with two soon-to-be three young sons in the rugged wilderness of Upland, South Carolina. She had raised the baby and his brothers as best she could and tried to protect them from the dangers of the war, but the boys had joined the fight despite her pleas. Hugh, the oldest, had died at age 16 of heat exhaustion after a battle the year before. Elizabeth was not about to lose her remaining sons now. Traveling the long distance to their prison, she managed to persuade the jailers to include them in a prisoner exchange. But freedom didn't mean safety. Robert had fallen dangerously ill, his wounds infected, and the family of three had many miles to travel on just two horses. Robert, delirious, rode one, and the exhausted Elizabeth the other. Andrew walked. He made the journey barefoot since the British had taken his shoes. Although all three made it home through driving rains, Robert died 2 days later. Elizabeth had no time to nurse her grief or her remaining son. As Andrew recovered from a fever, she set off for Charleston, where two of the nephews she helped raise were prisoners. she would never return. After completing a 160-mile journey, much of it through enemy territory, she became ill with cholera and died. Andrew learned he was an orphan when a small bundle of her clothing was returned to his home. Andrew Jackson would never forget the pain and humiliation of that summer. His father, mother, and brothers were dead. He himself bore the memory of British brutality, his forehead and hand forever marked by the British officer's sword, a reminder of the callous cruelty that had destroyed his family. His mother may have left him alone, but she had not left him without words to live by. Years later, he would report that she had told him, "Make friends by being honest and keep them by being steadfast. Never tell a lie, nor take what is not your own, nor sue for slander. Settle them cases yourself." Andy wouldn't forget her advice, and he would take care to settle more than just slander. Great Britain had left him an orphan, and one day he would settle that score. Chapter 1: Freedoms at Risk. There are times which distinguish the real friend of his country from the town meeting brawler and the sunshine patriot. The former steps forth and proclaims his readiness to march. Major General Andrew Jackson. On June 1, 1812, America declared war. After a hot debate, James Madison's war resolution was passed by a vote of 19-13 in the Senate, 79-49 in the House of Representatives. And, once again, the new nation would be taking on the world's premier military and economic power, Great Britain. 29 years had passed since the colonists' improbable victory in the Revolutionary War, and for 29 years the British had failed to respect America's sovereignty. Now, the nation James Madison led had reached the limit of its tolerance. Great Britain's kidnapping of American sailors and stirring up of Indian tribes to attack settlers on the western frontier had made life intolerably difficult for many of America's second generation, including those hard-scrabble men and women pushing the boundaries westward. Though reluctant to risk the new nation's liberty, Madison was now ready to send a message to England and the world that America would stand up to the bully that chose to do her harm. The unanswered question was, could America win? Less than 30 years removed from the last war, and with virtually no national army, were Americans prepared to take on Britain and defend themselves, this time without the help of France? The world was about to find out. In fact, so many Americans opposed the war that the Declaration posed a real risk to the country's national unity. The Federalist Party, mainly representing Northerners whose economy relied on British trade, had unanimously opposed the war declaration. Many New Englanders wanted peace with Britain, and it was likely that some would even be willing to leave the Union in order to avoid a fight. Yet, peaceful attempts at resolving the conflict with Britain had already been tried and hadn't helped the economy much. 5 years earlier, when a British ship attacked the U.S. Navy's Chesapeake, killing 3 sailors and taking 4 others from the ship to impress them into service to the Crown, then-President Thomas Jefferson had attempted to retaliate. To protest this blatant hostility, Congress passed the Embargo Act, prohibiting overseas trade with Great Britain. Unfortunately, the act hurt Americans more than the British. In just 15 months, the embargo produced a depression that cruelly punished merchants and farmers while doing little to deter the Royal Navy's interference and hardening New England's resistance to conflict. Further attempts at legislative pressure in the early years of James Madison's presidency had little effect, and British impressment had continued. By the time of the war declaration in June of 1812, the number of sailors seized off the decks of American ships had risen to more than 5,000 men. To many, including Andrew Jackson, then 40 years old, the attack on the Chesapeake alone had been an insult to American pride that demanded a military response. As Jackson wrote to a Virginia friend after learning of the Chesapeake's fate, "The degradation offered to our government has roused every feeling of the American heart, and war with that nation is inevitable." Yet America had waited, and the losses at sea mounted. At the same time, attempts to pacify the British had only resulted in further losses in America's new territory, the West, which ran south to north from the Gulf of Mexico to Canada, bounded on the west by the Mississippi. There, British agents were said to be agitating the Indians. For many years, the 5 civilized tribes in the region, the Cherokee, the Chickasaw, the Choctaw, the Creek, and the Seminole, had maintained peaceful relations with the European arrivals. But as more and more white settlers settled into native territories, tensions had risen and open conflict had broken out. In some places, travelers could no longer be certain whether the Native Americans they encountered were friendly. For inhabitants of the frontier, that meant the events of daily life were accompanied by fear. Stories circulated of fathers who returned from a day of hunting to find their children butchered, and of wives who stumbled upon their husbands scalped in the fields. A major Shawnee uprising at the Indian Territory in 1811 escalated that fear. And as the bloodshed increased, there were reports that the British were providing the Indians weapons and promising them land if they carried out violent raids against American settlers. For Andrew Jackson, the threat had become too close for comfort when, in the spring of 1812, just 100 miles from his home, a marauding band of Creeks killed 6 settlers and took a woman hostage. Jackson was certain the British were behind the attack on the little settlement at the mouth of the Duck River. Westerners like Jackson fumed at the government's inability to resolve the country's problems, but their clout in Washington was limited. The decision makers from Virginia and New England.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.